Right, well, that was your husband, nearly at the age of almost 40, in 1915. You had a husband who was born in 1876, 21 years before Brahms died. And here you are.
And here I am.
Now, can I ask you, when you married, how old was he and how old were you?
He was 80 and I was 20.
That's quite a difference. And what did your family think?
Well, my family, of course, was not very happy about it because, again, coming from Puerto Rico were such traditional family things. And, of course, they adored Casals, but they never expected something that I would say, no, I want to leave with Casals. They didn't want it. But, of course, I had to do it on my own because they would not relent. But they never did anything, and later on, because my father said, oh, this cannot happen, I will prevent it at any cost, but it didn't happen. And with the years, actually, my father and Casals became very good friends, and with my family, and they loved him. It was something that, well, of course it was unusual, I mean, there's no question about it.
I think one could say that, yes.
But, you know, it was a sentiment that I think transcended anything of what people believe in marriage. It's something that I knew that I needed to be with him because I had to help him. I had to contribute to whatever he was doing. It was not only musically speaking, which of course every note he played went right here, but, you know, all the things he was involved with, all the good things he was doing, I said, I want to help, you know, because after all, he was alone, actually.
Because I should have told you, by the way, that was Handel's Lager, Casals' first recording sessions in 1915. Yeah, he was alone. He had been married.
Yes.
Or twice, actually, hadn't he?
Yes.
The second time, not for very long. He was married to Susan Metcalf, a soprano, but that was years before, right?
That was in 1914.
1940.
But the year before this recording.
Yeah, that's amazing. He used to play recitals with her on the piano. And then later he was married to his housekeeper?
It wasn't a housekeeper. She was a very nice lady who had been, she and her former husband had been collaborating with the Pablo Casals Orchestra in Barcelona. Mm-hmm. When Casals decided to establish a real symphony orchestra in Barcelona, and that was in 19 or 20, she and her husband were very much involved in helping the orchestra. Casals started the orchestra all by himself. Little by little, he had supporters from Barcelona and Catalonia. But there were many people who were just volunteers, and she and her husband were volunteers. And years later, the husband died, and they were very good friends. And when Casals left in exile from Spain after the Franco regime took over in Spain, that was 1939, he left for Prades, France, the other side of the Pyrenees, in self-imposed exile. So he went there, and she followed, and a few friends followed, and a couple of family members followed, and that's how it started. And she went to live with another family, the Alavedras, who wrote the text of El Pesebre, and little by little she took over his household, and he was very grateful to her, and he loved her, and she loved him, and that was that.
Gosh.
It's a nice story, actually.
And then she died in the 40s?
No, she died just the year I arrived. I arrived in 1955 to Prades, and she just died, you know, at that time. Yes, yeah.
And let me say, and so you were born in Puerto Rico.
Yes.
And you studied the cello there.
And I studied the cello.
How come? I mean,
well, my family, they were all amateur musicians, and they were involved in things happening in Puerto Rico. And my uncle, who was a newspaper man and music critic, of course there was no other, was one of the people who started the Friends of Music in Puerto Rico, which was a society which brought all the artists that would come that way. And I mean, everybody was there, Heifetz, Rubinstein, everybody was there because they had to stop somewhere somewhere between the United States and South America, because Buenos Aires and Uruguay had very important music societies. As a matter of fact, Casals was there in 1908. So they always came through Puerto Rico. We knew that they stopped there. So my uncle said, why don't we, you know, start something so that they can do something here? And that's how it all started. And so I was going to concerts since I was a little girl. And of course, my uncle said, well, she has to study music. I started with the violin and then with the cello. And we used to have musicales at home every Saturday night with my parents' friends, amateurs who came to play chamber music. But since my uncle knew all these great artists, many times they came for lunch because they had to stay there 2 or 3 days or for dinner. But he never invited anyone for musicales because, of course, I mean, this was beneath their listening. But once in a while, some musicians that, you know, they stayed longer or something, oh, no, we want to come, and so they did. And there were a couple who came several times. And then as time went on, they said, oh, this little kid has talent. You know, you should really, you know, do something about it. And of course, I was studying with the people there. There was a family who came to Paris to study, so they were more sophisticated and very good musicians, the Figueroa family. So finally, one of the musicians, he was a bassoon player of all things, and he said, no, I have to do something. You have to bring this girl to the United States to study. So he, by himself, because he taught at the Manners College of Music at the time, took it upon himself. He says, you have to listen to this girl. You have to give her a scholarship. And that's how I went to New York to study at 13, and that was another crisis. Because, you know, at 13, you don't leave the house in Puerto Rico and go to the United States of America and another language, even though everybody learns English in Puerto Rico. But I was 13, so my father said, no, she has to go to a place where she'll be safe. So I went to Marymount School in the convent school, and there they took very good care of me, and I used to do high school and the college all at the same time. And it's funny because when I think of it, this was from 1950 to 54, and I used to carry the cello from 84th and 5th Avenue to 76th and Madison. That was a long way. Walking with my cello at night, I used to go to the orchestra rehearsals, and the nuns would wait for me. But I was in the streets alone with a cello, and now you cannot do these things anywhere. So safer world.
Ah, it was. And then how did you get to Casals?
Well, again, my uncle, who was always looking and he knew all the recordings of everybody, says, well, before that, he said, after a few years with a violin, that was when I was about 8 or 9, he said, no, you have to play the cello. You know, they brought a cello. Because, you know, there's no cellist in Puerto Rico and certainly not a woman cellist. And I think that's wonderful. So that's how I came to the cello. But anyway, once I was in Marymount and I was doing well and all that, my professor, Lev Rozanov, had been a pupil of Casals in Russia, where he used to go every year until 1914 or 17. And so with all of this, my uncle said, we should go to the festival. You know, that was when the Casals Festival started, 1950. We did not go to in 1950, but in 1951, he decided that I was going there. We were going. And it so happened that my teacher also. But there's another reason why I met Casals. I could have met Casals through the teacher, but no. It, by fate, as Casals, he believed in fate. He says, things happen because they have to happen. So his mother had been born in Puerto Rico, of all places. His family, from the mother's side, had emigrated to the United States, first to Santo Domingo, and then to Puerto Rico. And Casals' mother, they were all Catalans from Barcelona, was born in Puerto Rico and lived there until she was 18 years old. And she always spoke to him about Puerto Rico. Mm. My uncle, of course, knew that. And he had written to Casals, we're coming to Puerto Rico to, you know, to listen to you, and I hope we will have a moment to meet you, because, you know, we come from the land of your mother, and oh my goodness. So immediately he wrote, yes, when you come to Prague, let me know immediately, and I, after the festival is ended, and you have to come over to the house and everything. So that's how I met Casals.
It's amazing. And so, hang on, 51, you were what?
About 14, 15, see, yeah. 14.
But you didn't play to him then?
No, I didn't play to him. Okay. But he said, oh, she's, Rosano tells me that you're studying the cello. I said, yes, we're talking. He says, well, when you, and that you have some talent. And my uncle said, well, we'll see. And he said, well, when she finishes there in high school, the music school, please come. I want to hear her. And that's how it happened.
Amazing. All right, let's have some more music from Prades. I've always wondered how to pronounce it, and I know Prades.
Prades.
Anyway, right, so you come to Prades?
No, Prade, French.
Prade, okay.
Although Casals always said that Prade was still Catalonia, because way back in the 13th century, it was part of Catalonia, and they still speak Catalan there, by the way.
Oh, okay, Prades. So, and you came back in, what, 55 to study with him?
55, yes, right. And I started, like everybody else, vibrato, control of vibrato.
Quite right.
Scales, arpeggios. And of course, you know, playing pieces and the essence of music. It was really
and then
like
marriage. A the usual no. course of lessons.
Not quite so quick. You're telling the story too fast.
All right. Okay.
All right. So that's it. And the first time I then went to me, this was a whole revelation and immersion in French. I didn't know French. I learned Catalan because I lived with a lady also from the exile family. And then Casals, a few months later, he had to go to Zermatt and to give his master classes there. So he said, you should come to Zermatt. And so, of course, I went to Zermatt again, another world, so many cellists, so many musicians, because also Beg was there, and of course he was there. There were other master classes, not only the cello master classes at the time. And that was an opening of a whole new world for me, of music, of values, of so many things. And we went back to Prague, and of course, people in Puerto Rico got very excited about having a Puerto Rican go and study with Casals. So Casals was invited to Puerto Rico. And the president of the university had written to him, and he had declined. That was when I was supposed to come, et cetera, because they knew that Casals' mother was in Puerto Rico, and he'd never been for many reasons. Then it was arranged that we would go to Puerto Rico. He received a letter from the governor. He would be the guest of Puerto Rico. They would show him the place where his mother was born, et cetera, et cetera. And off we went to Puerto Rico. And it was very moving for him and also for me, because, you know, I was learning again many things. He found his mother's house, where his mother had been born. He visited there, he played in the little room in the house and everything. And he was very happy. So we went back to Prague. But while in Puerto Rico, he said, oh, this island, he fell in love with the island and the people. And he says, and the governor says, well, maybe you can come here and spend winters here with us. Wouldn't it be nice? You know, it's a warm weather, and then maybe you can tell us what we can do with our music. And Puerto Rico, there was always music. There was a tradition since the beginning, you know, since the Spaniards, etc. So it wasn't a total wasteland there. It was really, there were people who learned music and all that. and went to the States, and they enjoyed that. So he said, that I would like very much. And that's how it all started, the conversation of Casals going to Puerto Rico. And he says, well, we could have a festival here and then just, you know, make it, so see what the levels that they should aspire. And then what's the, do they have a conservatory? Well, they have little schools of music. No, you need a conservatory. Do you have an orchestra? Well, we have a little orchestra. Says, we can do all this. I mean, the education. So it was agreed that he was coming back, and they organized this festival. They called Sasha, they called, you know, all the friends that had been in Prague, and they all came to have
and
a festival.
And who paid for it? They're just the state?
The state. They just wanted to start that way, you know, because for a program for culture in Puerto Rico. So then, unfortunately, but it was, had to happen, as he used to say, right at the first rehearsal, he was so moved. He had everybody in the orchestra who had been in Prague, the soloist, people who he knew, and he was very moved, and he was very happy. He had the rehearsal intermission back to conduct. Ha! He has a heart attack right then and there. He staggered from the podium, and Sasha went to this. He said, no, I'm okay. And then he walked off, and then they had to take him because he had a heart attack. Okay, oh, big thing. And however, he was taken to the hospital, et cetera, et cetera. And then the musician says, well, we have to have this festival in his honor, and we have to go on. And it went on. You know, Sasha left, conducted most of the, they were guest conductors as well, but anyway, he led the whole thing, and the podium and the concerts that he was supposed to conduct, it was Sasha conducted, but from the concertmaster's seat. He said, nobody replaces the maestro while he is alive, or even after he's not there. But anyway, so the festival, the people responded, you know, there was a spirit, he's going to make it, because every day he was getting better and better and better. And that's how the festival started, mm-hmm. and that's how, let us say, the whole movement in Puerto Rico started. But also, that's how my marriage started, in a sense, because, of course, you know, he was there. I was the closest to him, so I never left the hospital. I never left for a minute. I was sort of in charge. Not because I felt that I was in charge, it's just I had to be there, and there he was, you know. So then, of course, his brother and sister-in-law came, and they were there, but they didn't have the same sort of closeness. I don't know why, but, you know, brother and sister-in-law, but okay. So I was there, but then my father and my mother says, enough, now they, you know, they come, so you come here and you go and visit, but that's enough, because people are already saying, well, what is this girl doing there all the time, you know? So they had heard that and were not happy. So he says, you can go there and that's fine, but all of that, but you stay here. So I said, I can't, because I know all his medications and this and that, and especially then when he went back to where he was staying in the apartment. So that was a struggle, in a sense of that, you know, just disagreement with my parents, and I would escape, and I would come and go, and, you know, the whole thing. Finally, he was leaving he had to leave to Prague, you know, he wasn't going to stay there forever, and he was getting better and all that. And, well, what to do? And, you know, he was unhappy, I was unhappy. So that's when we decided to get married. And we eloped, actually. No. Actually, we were married and off we go.
Really?
Yes, that's the way it went, without anybody knowing. My poor father, I still regret, because he was devastated the next day. And
well, he wasn't everybody at the wedding.
Oh, no. Nobody was at the wedding. Okay. Three or four people, Casals' doctor, and three or four friends.
Gosh. And how old was your father at this point?
My father must have been, he must have been 50. Yeah.
No.
No, it wasn't quite an It is. And when I look back, the only thing I regret is, you know, the pain I caused my parents for a while. Yeah.
For a while. But they became reconciled.
Yeah.
Because it was a great, famously great marriage.
Well, it worked, as they say.
Some thing that you brought over for us, which I've never heard, which is a bit of the slow movement of Beethoven's clarinet trio, Opus 11, but played on the violin or the clarinet?
No, it's Opus 11. Violin.
But
violin.
It is the clarinet.
Yeah.
Okay, and it's who's clarinet. The violinist?
Yeah, there is a violin.
But who is it? Schneider?
Alexander Schneider.
So Schneider and Eugene Istomin on the piano and Casals on the cello.
One was in Mexico City. He did the first performance because that's where most Spanish exiles had gone after the Civil War. And then from 1962 until 1993, every year he had three or four performances.
1962 until
1973. 73, yes, 1973, until the day, the year he died, he had conducted his Opus 7. Yes. So it was something that it fulfilled his wanting to go again around the world that he loved. He hadn't been here, he hadn't been in so many, Hungary, he hadn't been in so many places that he yearned to come back, you know, because he had wonderful memories. London, my God, England was very important to him in all those years, and he hadn't been here, and not in France, not anywhere to be heard. So he said, I have to go back to those places that were so wonderful and that, you know, gave me so much, and perhaps, you know, so he did it. And as I say, it's something that I was surprised, you know, new work, something out of style in a sense, because it's still very, very traditional music, that it would have such an impact, but it did.
Wonderful. And okay, we're going to, I don't want to run out of time, as I keep saying, but I do want to ask you, and I was going to play a bit of it, but we won't. His last concert with Courtauld, which was actually apparently Courtauld's last ever concert. And
yes,
of course, he'd been in the Courtauld Thibaut Casals trio for many years, much earlier. And then Courtauld behaved very badly during the war, which you can maybe tell us about. And then they had a reunion.
Well, this happened, just as he said. They were like brothers. I mean, they played together for so many years. They admired each other very much. Of course, Thibaut had died in a plane crash, but there was no more communication between them during all those years, even during his prod years. But the first time that he went to Zermatt, since he lived in Switzerland, he sent him a letter. He sent him a letter that
Courtauld sent Casals.
Sent Casals a letter, saying that, you know, it was about time, you know, that, you know, things should be arranged and you know, forgotten, and not forgotten, it will never be forgotten, but to try to get together again because of the friendship. So Casals answered him and said, yes, you know, I think it's time, you know, we did what different things, but now is time, you know, to work for better things in the future. So that letter was like that, and of course he wrote back saying, oh, how wonderful, thank you, and blah, blah. So Casals said, well, I'll invite him to Prague. Let's let him come and let's play a sonata, Beethoven, of course, the A major, which they used to play very often. And of course he was very happy. Of course, Casals wasn't even conscious that he hadn't been playing for quite a while. And he said, yes, he would come. So, you know, a great expectation about this whole thing. So Courtauld arrives in Prague. He hadn't seen him for, God, since during the war or before the war. And unfortunately, Courtauld was misled, and he walked from the hotel, the steep incline that there was from the hotel to the apartment where we were. And when he arrived, he was literally out of breath. So I opened the door, and but Casals was there. And when I saw him, I said to him like that, let him catch his breath. You know, he was waiting for him at the door. But I opened the door, and I went to Casals like that. So I said, oh, maestro, how wonderful. Please come here this way, trying to cover the whole thing. I said, come sit down. The maestro is so eager to see you. Please sit down. So I waited for a minute because he was actually white. And I said, oh, my God, I had never seen Courtauld. And I know what an old man looks like, I thought, but, you know, he looked so drained. So I sat him there, and I said, and then, of course, you know, there were big abrazos and tears of emotion and all that. So they talked, and then they said, well, what if we rehearse a little bit? Not today. Tomorrow we rehearse again, but let's see. So they start, and Courtauld was so, also because of the climb, he was so shaky that it was difficult. So Casals says, no, I think you better rest, and tomorrow we'll rehearse. So they rehearsed tomorrow, and he was okay, but shaky. And so Casals says, oh my God, I hope he can do it. And I was praying, I said, yeah, you'll be fine. We all remember when we played it here, remember when he played it there. So finally the concert comes. I was sitting, everybody who heard that rehearsal was sitting. And all of a sudden, Courtois played much better, relaxed and everything. Casals was so happy and so relieved that he got up after the first movement, went to the piano and embraced him and came back, which of course was very, very touching and all that. So that was the last time. No, it wasn't the last time, because after that he invited us to come by his house. And on the way to the ceremony, we did. And peace.
That's great.
Rain, and I think that was wonderful for both of them.
Yeah. And the recording, I mean, it's a disaster and it's wonderful.
Yes,
you know,
exactly.
They're not together at all. It's
yes.
But it's fantastic.
Yes.
It's just a wonderful
yeah.
document. All right. So now and then he used to go to Marlborough with you. And then he made those amazing appearances at the United Nations when he was 94, and then in Israel when he was 96.
Mm-hmm. Well, those were, again, for a cause. Actually, the first time he went to the United Nations was in 1957, the first time that he went to Puerto Rico, 58, no, after we were married. And he played there again with his message of peace, which, you know, verbal message of peace and all that. But then time went on, and again, there was El Pesebre, and the one he went to the United Nations with it as well. But the last time, the United Nations had asked him to write a hymn for the United Nations, which, by the way, the words are Auden's, W.H. Auden's words. And he went there, and at that time, unbeknownst to him, he was presented with the first Peace Medal of the United Nations. And not only did he conduct his hymn, but he conducted the double violin concerto with Isaac and Alexander Schneider, the triple concerto with Serkin, Horchowski, and Eugene, and the hymn. So it was a full program at 94. And then after he received the Medal of Freedom, then he gave a beautiful speech, very emotional, talking about peace, what we want is peace, and the birds in the sky sing peace as they go along. And then he played very shakily and moved the song of the birds.
That's beautiful.
For the last time. No, in Israel.
In Israel as well.
The next year.
Okay, so we hear some of the song of the birds. It's going to be painful to cut it off, but it's his signature. Thank you. cut that off. God, it's... Oh. That's really incredible.
Mm-hmm. Well...
All right.
Okay. Next.
So he lived to his 96, and then he went to Israel the summer of 73. He played that again. He played the Sarabande of the Fifth Suite for Golda Meir. I remember seeing on television. It was amazing. I mean, he just practiced every day. Right?
He practiced every day until the last minute. He used to play the piano. Two preludes and fugues of Bach as he got up. No, first, out for a walk on the beach in Puerto Rico or wherever, as long as he could. He did that also until the last day. Then he would come back, play two preludes and suites of Bach in the piano. Then he would have breakfast. And then he would start with the cello, scales, arpeggios, few little exercises that he used to do, and then little passages, and then a whole Bach suite. Monday, the first, Tuesday, the second, etc. But on Sunday, he would play the six again because he said it was the most challenging.
Right.
So that was his routine every day of his life. Even after he came back from Israel in October 1973, he lived a wonderful life, but the discipline, the faith, the power, but mainly the faith. He was a man of faith, a man of hope. He was a positive personality. That's what kept him going. And because he believed in the human beings and we can make it better, he kept saying, it will get better. So that paid in his own life because he suffered many, I mean, a long life of 97 practically years. He had many problems in his life, but he was always positive.
And he said his years with you were the happiest ever.
Well,
I'm
very honored and very pleased and very happy that that happened, yes.
All right, and then we've talked about him so much, of course you've had an extremely distinguished career. You were president of the Kennedy Center in Washington.
Yes. And the Manhattan director, yes.
Artistic director.
Yeah, right.
And well, the Manhattan
same
School
thing.
Of Music. Manhattan School of Music.
Yeah.
Amazing. And you, after Casals' death, sometime after, you had another very happy marriage.
Yes,
Eugene Istomin, whom unfortunately I never met. I talked to him on the phone once when I was trying to find you. But yes. And we thought before we have questions and answers, it would be perfect. Martita's bought a CD of Istomin playing a prelude for piano by Casals. And I'm just going to vanish while it's on, not because I'm not interested, I must hear it later.
Yes.
Not because I'm going to the loo, but I have to go and fetch something.
No, of course, we've talked too much, maybe.
Nonsense. So while you listen to that, before the questions and answers,
yes,
I'm just going to fetch something.
Bye-bye.
So.
Casals never wanted to publish his compositions. This was something that he felt that he had to do. He went to Madrid actually to study music as a composer, not as a cellist. A lot of people don't know that. So he always felt, he said, I am always full of music. He always felt that he had to compose, but he did it for himself. And of course, during his times of great career, he did not have much time, but he did compose a lot of things that people are beginning to discover. And there are many beautiful things, many beautiful things.
Right, and of course, wonderful to hear your second husband playing your first husband's music. And you said the last time you were here at the Wigmore Hall was?
Was when Eugene gave a recital here. I think it was in 92 or 3. And he played here, and Slava Rostropovich was here, and he came to the concert, and we were sitting back there together. So that was a lot of fun. You know, we were great friends also with Slava. So, yes, I mean, I have been so privileged, you know, to know so many people. And all those people that I met, it was always in a wonderful, friendly atmosphere of music and respect, and it was wonderful. I have to be very grateful, and before you end, I have to say that I'm very honored that Stephen invited me here, because I've heard so many stories from London, from Casals, from Eugene, from everybody. Oh, another time was when Monteux was here, and Casals was playing his, conducting his El Pesebre, and the Istomin Stern Roast was here, so we had dinner together, and it was a blast, it was a feast, it was wonderful. So, all those many memories, and I thank you for being here, and I give you Casals' old love for London, Eugene's old love for London, and I'm privileged to also be on stage. I'm usually backstage.
Yes, all right, well, I thought if we have any questions from anybody. Yes, and there's a, sorry, wait till the microphone gets to you, sorry.
Did Casals have a relationship with Moïse in Marlborough?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, you know, they were friends, you know, in way back then they were not so much together, although they had met already in France. But it was wonderful every time they started talking together about all the musicians of their time in Paris, etc. Oh, yes, indeed. And Blanche Moïse was there also until only recently. She only died last year. She was, had the choral program there in her charge. Oh, it was a wonderful group of people that first Marlborough years, those Marlborough years, yes.
Anybody else? All right, well, talkative lot. Yes. Sorry, just wait till the microphone gets down. Oh, maybe yes. Just shout it out.
Oh, yes. Well,
so Casals' first concert in Budapest.
First concert in Budapest. When might that have been? Oh, my God.
Well, it was well before the Second World War.
Oh, yes.
My mother said that the first time nobody knew about him, so there weren't many people. But next day, people were crawling in between the seats.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, he loved Budapest. He went there and he had great friends, the Familia Daragni, I remember, and all that. And the last time he was in Budapest was with his, again with his El Pesebre. And of course, Kodály was still there, and we went and had dinner together, and he heard the children sing for him. It was a love feast again, you know, with because he had so many friends. Of friends, I mean, friends like you, probably family of friends who had known him so well.
And
thank you.
And you had dinner with Kodály and his also very young wife.
And also his very young wife. So there we there we are. Yeah. And then Casals invited him to Marlborough, and he came to Marlborough with his very lovely, beautiful young wife.
Yes, he's still around,
very
isn't
nice.
He?
Yes, I think. I'm sure.
Actually, I heard, a rather drier story about Casals' visit to Budapest. Well, I heard about, I think, the same concert from two men, I'm sure of whom both you, well, in one case knew and the other know. One was Laurent Fenyves, who was this, do you know him?
Gorgeous
Hungarian, old Hungarian, violinist. And then from Janos Stocker, and they told me same sort of story about the same concert, but slightly different reactions.
Which concert?
The Casals in Budapest.
Oh, well, but when was that? Way before?
When they were both children.
Well, that's it.
But Fenyves told me about how he couldn't get a seat, but he said when it came for the encores, people just rushed in because they were allowed. And he was just telling, he said he still remembered the way the Schubert Moment Musical, the way Casals played it. It's incredible. And he just told me with sort of tears streaming down his cheeks. And then Starker also told me about, he said, I was sitting there waiting for the concert. We waited. And then eventually, Casals came on, bowed, smiled, played. He said, and then I found out what had happened was that Casals said he had to be paid in cash for that concert. And the manager didn't have it. So Casals said, okay, I'm not going on stage. So it's slightly drier. I liked. It does show the difference in personalities between Benivesh and Starker. All right, are there any more questions? Yes.
There's one question if I could ask you.
Me?
Yes.
I'm not important here, but okay.
When did you first hear Pablo Casals?
Oh, only on record. I never heard him live. I wanted to go to Israel because I was 14. And I said, I knew he, and there was an old cellist there. You may have known, Joachim Stuchevsky.
Yes, of course.
Okay, well, I'd known him. Yes. He even dedicated a piece to me because I played to him when I was very young. Can Stephen come to Israel? And he said, I just can't take responsibility. So I couldn't go, but that was my...
Oh, it's too bad.
That was my... would have been my only chance to hear Casals. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Casals is God.
He would have liked you.
Oh, well, I would have loved him. I knew Vague, so who went on about Casals. I think Vague was a little less kind than Casals. He was a different character, but also great musician.
But he was also a wonderful musician. And a good man, yes. Indeed.
When he wasn't pouring beer over my head, yes, he was a good man.
Well, sounds like a prank to me.
It was pretty wet. Okay, so maybe we should finish now with some music. And I'm feeling very uncomfortable about this because we just heard the greatest cello playing of all time. But I did want to play something for you. And I must say, I've hardly touched the cello in a couple of days. And I just should say this because I know a lot of people know my father, who would have loved to be in here, but he's been very, very ill in hospital in the past few days. He's almost 95, so I've been in hospital all day. But just when I went backstage to fetch the cello, I got a text saying he's much better today.
Yay!
So we have, God, that's why Song of the Birds got to me, I think, so much. Anyway, you play your piece. You probably know it, but I don't know if you know it. And it is by Casals. And it was written, I believe, as a sight reading test for the Paris Conservatoire, I think. And I cannot remember why
I don't know
it
then.
You don't know it. So Sam Hayward, my great friend Sam Hayward, has kindly agreed to come and play, and we will play you.
It must be difficult.
It is. I couldn't sight read it. I can't even play it. Let alone sight read it.
How are you again? Good. My goodness. That's wonderful.
I wish I could remember who said it.
Bravo. Lovely. I'm sure the
Oh yes, he and Cesar Cui. He also. I always remember Glazunov, Cesar Cui. But Glazunov, he said he was really a great musician, and he was he admired his orchestrations. You know how much imagination he had.
What did he feel about Prokofiev and Shostakovich?
Well, Prokofiev, his first period he accepted, but once they started with atonal music, although he could.
They never wrote atonal music.
Well, Prokofiev, you know.
Shostakovich
did more than.
What's atonal?
Yes.
I can't think of one piece that's atonal about Shostakovich.
Well, for him it was. No, but I know exactly what he meant. I wish I could show you exactly where. But anyway, but he felt that they were masters of music, obviously.
Yeah.
Yes.
And he must have been friends with Schoenberg. Schoenberg did the Molly concerto.
Yes,
they
did. Until he went to the 12th tone.
Yeah.
They were friends even after the 12th tone.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, there is a very sad sort of the memoirs of Schoenberg.
Yeah.
Yeah, when he was having a terrible time in I don't know, wherever he was, and there's a very touching correspondence between them. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. And Stravinsky, I'm sure he was not friends with.
No, he never had met him, actually, because Stravinsky was in America.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
He never
But they're in Paris at the same time.
Yeah.
And did he like any of the music?
Well, he could admire some of the... He admired
and
the
he
first
did
part
get
again.
Yeah,
yes,
the first
part.
The Petrushka and all those he loved. So he thought, wonderful. All that, but after that, when he went...
It's true, Casals would have been very upset about the state of the world, but he would have been quite pleased about how composition, how modern music is going, because so much of it is total.
Oh, now it's sort of coming back.
Yeah, it is.
That's what he said, he's going to come back. But he didn't see it.
No. But do you see the genius of Emmanuel Moore? I never have.
I don't know enough of his music to judge. Because I didn't hear him play, there's nothing really recorded, so I cannot tell. I don't know. You played some? Well, you
just
tried.
Just the prelude.
You tried.
And the suite for four cellos. Yeah, it just doesn't. No, I played a sonata or concerto for two cellos. And I'm learning
but the
that
concerto,
when I was a teenager.
It's the concerto, which he took the big risk of playing in Vienna.
I know.
So that I would have liked. That I would like to hear.
Rubinstein says in his memoirs, he says, the piece was insignificant, but Casals is playing wonderful. Actually, it's quite clever to play a piece that nobody knows, if you're nervous, which he was, apparently. About playing
he was dying before playing there,
that's
because at the
bow.
Time it was,
But, it is quite good to play a piece that nobody knows, because it is relaxing, comparatively. But I'll give him play I was just reading in Paul Klee's
but he played that every day, practically. That was part of the... Anyway.
I was just reading in Paul Klee's memoirs about Haydn, about Casals playing Haydn concerto. Paul Klee was in the orchestra.
I didn't know.
And Casals hated the conductor, apparently.
He hated the most conductor. not really, because he loved Barbaroli. He loved him all these times at the time. I know, he was cute.
Was he?
When he came to Puerto Rico to conduct, he was so high. And the way he rehearsed, you know, everybody, he had everybody in stitches.
Oh, really?
Yes, you know, we used to go, and he would be conducting here, and all of a sudden, you know, the double bass is over there, he would go, wait a minute, what did you do there? And he would, and where, what? Oh, okay, play for me. Oh, there's something is wrong. So then he would conduct them there, and then he would do that around the orchestra. I've never seen anything like that. And the musicians were wonderful. You know, his Casals Orchestra was really wonderful. Yeah. They enjoyed him so much because musically he had a lot to say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he drank.
Well, not during the rehearsal.
He used to drink before rehearsals, apparently.
Well, we didn't see
in his
that.
Later years, but he was still wonderful.
But that's why maybe he was so relaxed, so yes. Funny on stage.
Restaurant.
Lunch, Moroccan lunch?
Anything. I am you must be multi.
You have varied tastes.
Yes.
Young man, old man.
Well, that was when.
That was when.